Ladies and gentlemen, I am John Pace, a member of the R.M. Santilli Foundation and the chairman of the World Lecture Series on Hadronic Mathematics, Mechanics, and Chemistry. It is a pleasure and honor for me to introduce Professor Ruggero Maria Santilli for delivering Lecture 2E on the novel isodual mathematics he had to build to achieve a consistent treatment of antimatter at all levels, from Newtonian mechanics to second quantization. The lecture begins with Professor Santilli illustrating the historical imbalance of the 20th century between matter and antimatter, caused by the fact that matter was treated at all levels, from Newtonian mechanics to second quantization, while antimatter was solely treated in second quantization. Professor Santilli then shows that the imbalance is a direct consequence of the inability by Einstein's special and general relativity of providing a consistent classical representation of antimatter due to the absence of any distinction between neutral matter and antimatter and other insufficiencies. Professor Santilli then points out the risk for mankind resulting from the above imbalance due to our apparent inability of seeing with sunlight antimatter asteroids that can possibly hit our planet with potentially large devastation, such as that of the 1908 Tunguska explosion in Siberia that was caused by an antimatter asteroid because, despite the energy equivalence of 1,000 atomic bombs, the asteroid left no crater or debris whatsoever in the ground, thus being solely due to an antimatter asteroid. Consequently, a serious understanding of this lecture requires the knowledge that Professor Santilli's isodual mathematics has a direct social relevance, since it allows the quantitative treatment of the problem of the detection of antimatter asteroid. This lecture also illustrates the rather unique capabilities by Professor Santilli of achieving important mathematical discoveries, such as the construction ab initio of the basically novel iso, gano, and isodual mathematics, and then using these new mathematics for important discoveries in physics and chemistry for matter as well as antimatter. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my sincere pleasure and honor to introduce Professor Santilli for the delivery of this important lecture initiating new fields of antimatter physics, astrophysics, and cosmology.
Ladies and gentlemen, we shall now initiate our study of antimatter. In this first lecture, we shall study antimatter from a mathematical viewpoint. In level 3, we shall study antimatter from a physical viewpoint. And finally, in level 5, we shall study antimatter from an experimental viewpoint, presenting fundamentally new experiments that are under consideration for conduction. Let us begin by reviewing what is well known as one of the biggest scientific imbalances of the 20th century. And it is given by the fact that matter was treated at all possible level of studies, namely from Newton to Hamiltonian mechanics and then quantization, first and second quantum mechanics, while antimatter was only studied at the level of second quantization. Clearly, this is an imbalance caused particularly by lack of scientific democracy. Namely, there is a structural difference between the treatment of matter and antimatter that, of course, has a number of rather serious consequences that we will study, some of which in this lecture and the other in the following lecture. The origin of the imbalance is well known and is given by the fact that Einstein's special and general relativity have no quantitative means for a deep and comprehensive, or if you want, axiomatically correct differentiation between matter and antimatter. In fact, at the level of special relativity, matter is characterized by the Casimir invariant of the Poincaré symmetry that, as you can see, have only one characterization, this one. So there is no distinction between matter and antimatter as far as the Casimir invariant is concerned. At the level of general relativity, it is well known that Einstein conceived gravitation for matter to describe the gravitational field of a planet, of the sun, or a star in general. So therefore, the insufficiency of both special and general relativity for the characterization of antimatter are well known. At this point, I have to defend Albert Einstein, because the imbalance which I have indicated a moment ago absolutely was not due to Albert Einstein. No, for a very simple reason, that the antimatter did not exist at the time of the conception and formulation of special and general relativity. Antimatter was discovered several years later. So the imbalance was due in reality to Einstein followers, and not by Einstein. Einstein followers who abuse Einstein's name in this particular case, in my view, because they extended Einstein the theory to all possible conditions existing in the universe, expectedly in their hope, until the end of time, and therefore they extended the applicability of special and general relativity also to antimatter. The net result has been a rather widespread belief throughout the entire 20th century that antimatter do not exist in the universe, or if it exists, is a kind of an aberration, exists in a very small amount, insignificant. For instance, the antimatter astrophysics, as a branch of astrophysics, does not exist, never existed throughout the entire 20th century. It is our duty, however, to bring to your attention that the reality is rather different than those political posturing. To begin with, nowadays we have a fundamentally open problem as to whether we can indeed detect with matter light, namely with the light emitted by the sun, whether we can detect an antimatter asteroid or not, according to the Einstein followers, not Einstein, but according to Einstein followers, the problem does not exist, because they predict only one type of light, and therefore that type of light is predicted to being single and unique, is predicted to be refracted by an asteroid, whether of matter or antimatter, and therefore we can see an antimatter asteroid with the light emitted by sun. However, as you will see in a moment, this is a consequence of the insufficiency of the theory. Once a quantitative representation, axiomatically consistent quantitative representation of antimatter is indeed identified, then one of the consequences, there are two types of lights, lights emitted by matter and a light emitted by an antimatter star, in which case light emitted by a matter star annihilates on an antimatter asteroid without refraction, resulting in a very serious problem for the safety of our planet that has to be resolved by society at large, with particular reference by scientific community. Also, another point that has to be dismissed is that our planet has already been hit by antimatter asteroids. And here I bring to your attention the case of the 1908 Tunguska explosion in Siberia. That was an explosion equivalent to 1,000 atomic bombs. Yet it left no crater whatsoever. That can only be explained by an antimatter asteroid that annihilated in our atmosphere. And that's the only possibility for leaving no crater or no residue, no solid residue whatsoever on the ground. But there is more, the entire atmosphere of Earth was so excited by this explosion that people were able to read at midnight newspapers in London, in Sydney, Australia, and so on. This excitation of the atoms, of our atmosphere, can only be explained by the fact that that our atmosphere had been invaded by an enormous amount of of radiation of light, if you want, and that can, in turn can only be explained by the annihilation of an antimatter asteroid in the atmosphere. In conclusion, the only scientific, that is numerical, representation of the Tunguska explosion is that it was caused by a very large antimatter asteroid. By comparison, the others are purely political. The explosion of a matter asteroid in the upper atmosphere would have left enormous craters, not for an explosion equivalent to 1,000 atomic bombs. And similarly for the other interpretation, in my view, are political. And namely, they try to adapt the event to a preferred theory, which is Einstein. Special and general relativity, but they are not quantitative, and therefore they are not scientific, and therefore they are political. There has been other phenomena in our upper atmosphere that can only be explained due to antimatter asteroid. We will review them in a lecture of level 3. There is also evidence in other galaxy of the existence of antimatter. That we will also review in details in the lecture of level 3. The references have now accumulated in this new field, which is basically is called as an antimatter astrophysics and cosmology, is rather vast, and it's available in free PDF download. I can only mention here a monograph that I wrote in 2001, published by Springer, that is available for everybody to download. It's a little bit kind of obsolete now, being on 2001, it's 10 years old, but nevertheless it gives all the foundations that particularly of this lecture with respect to the mathematical viewpoint. Very well, let's see what the objective of this lecture is. Well, our task is to identify a representation of antimatter that achieves full democracy with matter. So therefore, going back to the preceding transparency, that we have to write here antimatter, yes, at all those levels. Now, clearly, this objective, namely the achievement of full democracy of treatment between matter and antimatter, requires a new mathematics. Can only be achieved not only with mathematics, but with a new mathematics. Let me elaborate. Well, as it is well known, in the transition from matter to antimatter, there is a conjugation. We will see very soon is an anti-Hermitian conjugation. Now, the issue is, do we have in mathematics in the orthodox presentation that is anti-isomorphic to the conventional mathematics used for matter? The answer is no. For instance, do we have a sinus and cosinus that are formulated in such a way to be anti-isomorphic to the conventional sinus and cosinus used for matter? The same for the differential calculus and derivative, integral, symmetry, etc., etc. The answer is no. As a matter of fact, one of the most important messages of this series of lectures is that whenever there is a major physical problem that is unresolved for extended period of time, the origin of the problem is the lack of a sufficient mathematics for its proper quantitative treatment. Again, the scientific imbalance originated and was entirely due to a lack of an appropriate mathematics that lasted for close to a century. So, in general, those problems are not due to physical insufficiency. They are due instead to insufficient mathematics. Well, my idea when I addressed this problem, I was at Harvard University in the late 70s. My idea is, let me try to construct a new mathematics that rather than being based on the number 1, is based on the number minus 1. Namely, we have numbers, whose unit is minus 1 rather than 1. We have new fields, new spaces, and new algebra, new geometry, new topologies, etc. This approach was promising because this will assure a mathematics that is anti-Hermitian, anti-isomorphic in this case, talking about reals, the conventional mathematics used for matter. But let me report an episode regarding the reaction by mathematician to this transparency. We had made a true pilgrimage to Palermo to visit Sicily, to visit the Circolo Matematico di Palermo, that they publish a famous purely mathematical journal called Rendiconti del Circolo Matematico di Palermo. To my extreme surprise and pleasure, the historical mathematics journal had dedicated an entire issue of to the treatment of isomathematics and isotopy. Isotopy that had been presented in preceding lecture of this series. So due to this very, very great honor, I felt compelled to go to Palermo and say thanks, which I did, to the editor, Professor Vetro. I want to have his name remembered with immense appreciation and gratitude, particularly when compared to the repulsive attitude of other mathematical journals. While I was there, Professor Vetro told me, Professor Santilli, at this moment there is in Palermo a purely mathematical meeting. Do you want to present your new mathematics? I said, yes, but I don't know if I have a slot. I said, no, I'll take care of that. So he called the organizer and he located for me a 15-minute opening due to the absence of one of the speakers. So I went there and I presented myself. I am a physicist. And I appreciate your 15 minutes, and I projected this transparency to start my presentation with the statement, we have constructed in mathematics, was basic unit is minus one. At that statement, at the appearance of this transparency, and that statement, there was, in Italian we'll say, putiferio. There was a great commotion that occurred in why? Because I was bombarded by all sorts of questions from all corners. They started discussing among the auditors, after discussing among themselves. They were asking and repeating questions. To make a long story short, it is true, I was unable to pass to the second transparency. My presentation ended here with this, that there was no possibility of presenting what are the isodual numbers are. I wanted to remember this episode because it's symptomatic on the mentality of mathematicians. Usually they think that mathematics of the 20th century has reached the end of the end, and so they work in tiny, details of an established doctrine. In reality, it is my personal opinion that the mathematical knowledge is at its infancy. And there is so many fundamentally new mathematics yet to be discovered and to be developed. This is only one of a large number in this series you have heard of. Isomathematics, genomathematics, hypermathematics, this is isodual mathematics. Well, let's go to the inception of this new mathematics. First, let's see them discuss briefly the name isodual mathematics. Well, I propose the name isodual because the new mathematics had to have the word dual as a duality of the conventional mathematics of the 20th century. But I wanted to also give the idea with the word iso, which means in the Greek isos, same topology. I want to give the idea that there is no fundamental change of the axioms of 20th century mathematics by conception, because we want to simply have a duality in passing from the mathematics used for matter to the mathematics used for antimatter. Have a conjugation, but the axiom to be the same. So the word isodual mathematics remain, in this case isodual map, and it is generally indicated with an upper symbol D. Now, what is this isodual map or isodual conjugation? Well, it's essentially, its origin can be seen in the conventional charge conjugation, which, as it is well known, it is anti-Hermitian conjugation. Namely, you have minus the Hermitian conjugate, in this case, for the state of a Hilbert space. If you look at the isodual map, it's essentially the same. It's an anti-Hermitian conjugation. So what's the novelty? Well, the novelty is rather deep, particularly from a physical viewpoint. As we will see in a moment, you can see here that charge conjugation leaves the space unchanged. So basically, by very conception, the antimatter, in according to conventional 20th century theory, antimatter exists in our own space-time, which is indicated by the letter X. If you go instead to the isodual mathematics, one of the central assumptions is that antimatter exists in a space which is structurally, physically different than our space, yet coexists with our space-time. So this has a number of epistemological and other implications. From a mathematical viewpoint, charge conjugation is an anti-homomorphism, is a map of a space into itself. In fact, as you can see, the variable, the space coordinates do not, space and time coordinates do not change. As far as the isodual map instead is concerned, then it is an anti-isomorphism because it's a map from one space into a completely different space. Another major difference is that charge conjugation only applies, as it is well known, in quantum mechanics. You need a Hilbert space and a related formalism to apply charge conjugation. Outside quantum mechanics, charge conjugation has no known application that is worth reporting in this lecture. When we pass to the isodual map, instead we have a dramatic difference, because by conception the isodual map is applicable at all level of treatment. As we will see, is applicable beginning with numbers, real number, complex number, quaternion, and then it's applicable to spaces, and then of course differential geometry, differential calculus, functional analysis, the symmetries, and so on. So, and by as a result of the systematic application of this isodual map to the totality of the mathematics of the 20th century, and then we have a comprehensive means of quantitative treatment of antimatter at all levels. From an historical viewpoint, it is a pleasure for me to indicate the duty. To indicate that I had the idea of the isodual mathematics by studying deeper and deeper and deeper the most fundamental equation of 20th century, namely Dirac equation. As you can see in the conventional formulation, the gamma 4 contains a positive definite 2x2 unit and a negative definite 2x2 unit for the remaining part. And then I looked at the other component, the gamma 1, 2, 3, and they had precisely the structure of the Pauli matrices on one side for 2x2 corresponding to the positive unit as requested by Lie algebra. Then the others, they were precisely anti-Hermitian conjugate. So I said, this is precisely the structure of charge conjugation, but however interpreted as an operator map. I should also remember a statement that I made a number of times during those lectures, namely that I never accepted the conventional interpretation of Dirac equation as representing one particle with spin 1/2. Why so? Because since the time of my graduate studies in physics, I had acquired some knowledge of Lie algebra, and therefore I knew that there exists no four-dimensional, irreducible representation of the SU2 spin algebra characterizing spin 1/2. The only one has to be two-dimensional, not four-dimensional. I also knew that there exists no reducible, four-dimensional representation of the SU2 spin algebra with the structure of the gamma matrices. So therefore, I had no way of verifying in a quantitative form, a rigorous form, this interpretation. So I start looking deeper and deeper into the Dirac equation and see what's the mystery that is hidden into the Dirac equation. The net result is that the Dirac equation indeed represents two particles with spin 1/2, a particle and an antiparticle, the second one being anti-Hermitian conjugate. The implications are very, very deep, because this eliminates the treatment of antiparticle at the level of second quantization via the historical Hall theory, which is completely eliminated. Also because the isodual treatment of antimatter starts at the class, purely classical level, let alone the level of first quantization. We will look at those aspects in the physical part. But in conclusion, again, it's a great honor and pleasure for me to indicate that the biggest inspiration for the isodual theory, antimatter, originated with one of the biggest geniuses of the 20th century, Paul Dirac, that is one of my mentors, and I have an unbounded esteem and for such a scientist. Very well, let's begin with isodual numbers. I was in 1993, I was at the visiting professor of the Joint Institute for Nuclear Research in Dubna, Russia. And at that time, I discovered the isodual numbers that have been treated in preceding lectures of this series. Jointly with the discovery of isodual number, I also discovered that the axiom of a field, of a numerical field, do not necessarily require that the unit be positive definite. No, there is no such a restriction whatsoever for the verification of the field. So therefore, I discovered that the axiom of a field admit indeed the realization of the unit as being negative definite. This was crucial for the entire new conception of isodual mathematics for antimatter. Because again, without numbers, there is not we physicists there is nothing we can do. So everything has to start from numbers, and those numbers have to verify the axiom of a field. They have to be actual numbers, otherwise, because we have to predict numbers that to be verified with experiments. So the fact that the axiom of a field admitted a realization or admitted numbers with a negative unit is fundamental for everything that we have to say on antimatter. Let's review together the very, very central points on isodual numbers and isodual fields. The technical treatment has to be studied in the original paper as well as in the monograph published by Springer. Consider a conventional field of real complex or quaternion. As you remember, we do not consider octonions as number because they violate the associativity law of the multiplication. The central point is that if we assume a negative unit as the basic unit of the new field, then we must modify the product in such a way to admit minus one as the correct left and right unit. And this is very trivially done by sandwiching between the product of any two numbers, sandwiching the inverse of minus one, inverse for certain algebraic reason. Once you have assume this new multiplication and you call it isodual multiplication, and all products are done via this new multiplication, then it's very easy to prove that that minus one is the correct left and right unit of the new set of the new ring, and then it's very easy to verify that the set this F isodual. That this new set given by ordinary numbers, but the new multiplication and the new unit, verifies all the axioms of a field. More rigorously, however, to be consistent, the isodual map has to be applied to the totality of quantities, and therefore has to be applied also to the number themselves. The number themselves have to be redefined to be element of the isodual field, and therefore they have to be multiplied by the isodual unit. If you do so, then you have absolutely axiomatic consistency at all level. From on curiosity ground, the isodual numbers, namely numbers with minus one as basic unit, are rather curious. For instance, if we live in an antimatter world, and then you say $3,000 in the checking account means that we are in the red of $3,000, because this $3,000 are computed with respect to the minus $1, and so therefore they are in the red. So to be in the positive, we have to be under of $3,000. So if we have minus, our account has to have minus $3,000, that when referred to minus $1, is indeed indicates that we have usable money. There are all sorts of very strange features that I strongly recommend interested colleagues to learn, to acquire this new mentality that has to be developed to handle ISO dual numbers. Because in the absence of this new way of thinking, there are insidious misconception and also inconsistency that may originate without the awareness of the colleague. Okay, then we now pass to the ISO dual functional analysis. I can only flash it. It's elementary. Its construction is elementary. Just notice that there is the ISO dual map is applied not only to the function, but is applied also to the argument. You have to conjugate everything. If you miss one quantity in this ISO dual map, then you end up with inconsistencies that are insidious, because you are not that easily detected. So we have the isodual sinus and cosine. First we have isodual angles, and then isodual sinus and cosinus, and then for all the other quantities that can be easily calculated, isodual logarithm, isodual trace, etc. This is also a necessary step for the elaboration, correct elaboration of isodual treatment of antimatter. The next another very fundamental stumbling block is that delayed the achievement of maturity in the treatment of antimatter for many years. Prior to 1996, the formulation of antimatter were inconsistent, and we could not identify the origin of the inconsistency. It was only in 1996 that finally I realized that the inconsistency lied where nobody would expect it, namely in the ordinary differential calculus. Because for centuries and centuries, actually since Newton, the differential calculus has been tacitly referred to the trivial unit, which is the number one. And in this case, it emerged that indeed the differential calculus can be reformulated consistently with respect to a negative unit, minus one. And the implications turn out to be by far non-trivial. Only after we achieved this isodual formulation of the differential calculus, finally the isodual mathematics was consistent, and we could start practical application. Notice here how the isodual formulation of the differential calculus is hidden in the conventional differential calculus. As a matter of fact, the isodual differential of a quantity coincides with ordinary differential. So it's very, very insidious in that sense, that that's the reason why escapes this formulation of the differential escapes for century, because of this identity. Since the duality of both the differential and the coordinates cancel out, and you obtain the original version. The same for the derivative. As a matter of fact, this invariance is now called isoself dual, namely, it is an invariance under the separation of under the isodual map, or if you want, is an invariance under anti-hermeticity. The first quantity that has this invariance is the imaginary unit, because minus the Hermitian conjugate of the imaginary unit is the imaginary unit itself. So the differential calculus at this property, the derivative, and many other quantities emerged as having this invariant. In particular, Dirac equation emerged as having being invariant under anti-hermeticity. And therefore this confirmation that indeed represents a tensorial product of a particle and an antiparticle, which as such it is invariant under conjugation from matter to antimatter. There are now even cosmology that assume that the entire universe is isoself-dual. And this is a mathematical language to say that the universe is made up half of matter and half of antimatter, of course, as a limit case, with very intriguing features that we will see at the end of this lecture. The next we have to briefly outline the ideas of isodual spaces. Again, to formulate them properly, you have to subject to the isodual map the totality of the mathematics underlying conventional spaces such as the Euclidean space or the Minkowski space, or if you want, the Riemannian space. Now, this implies first the isodual conjugation of the basic numbers. Remember, metric or pseudometric spaces are formulated on defined over a certain field of number, in this case, real. So we have now indicated the fundamental conjugation of fields. After that, you have to conjugate the coordinates. And then after that, you have to conjugate the metric. When you do that, you discover again something very very unexpected, for instance, the Euclidean and Minkowski spacetime are the line element is isoself dual, namely it is invariant under this upper this isodual map, and which is another indication of this coexistence of matter and antimatter in the same region of the universe, but although defined, however careful, defined on structurally different space-time. The ordinary space-time for matter and the conjugate space-time for antimatter. And this coexistence in the same region of space has very intriguing epistemological aspect, even some religious aspect, which will hopefully will indicate in the in the lecture of level 3. So again, this illustrates the hidden character of the of this isodual map and the reason why it was not discovered for centuries. Next, we have to subject to isodual map the entire Lie theory, because as we will know, special relativity is fundamentally dependent on the Poincaré symmetry. So we have to construct the isodual of the Poincaré symmetry, today called the Poincaré-Santilli isodual symmetry. To do so, we have to start from a base of a conventional Lie algebra, for instance, that of the Poincaré symmetry. In this case, the generators are Hermitian, and so therefore the isodual map is trivial. It's just a change of sign. But nevertheless, when you go to them a little bit deeper into the construction of the isodual map of Lie theory, you see some non-trivial elements. For instance, the basis of the isodual Poincaré-Birkhoff-Witt theorem is non-trivial due to the the alternation of positive and negative changes of the monomials is not that simple. And then when you use this infinite dimensional basis to construct the exponentiation, which is the fundamental element of Lie groups, then you will see that it's non-trivial, because you don't have only a minus in front. No way. You have a minus in front, but you also have a minus in the exponent and the conjugation, and the Hermitian conjugation in the. So if your basis is not Hermitian, the transition from Lie theory to what is called the Lie-Santilli isodual theory is by far non-trivial and can be very tricky unless treated properly. The same for groups. It was very easily. Oh, this is the second Lie theorem. It's very easy conjugation. That can be located in this monograph at Springer for anybody who wants to study this in details. And the same the conjugation for the Lie groups was also if you apply the isodual map systematically, step by step, component by component, symbol by symbol of Lie theory, you reach this conjugate. It's not a covenant, it's a conjugate formulation of Lie theory, which is totally self-sufficient and quite intriguing, I would like to say. Doing so, in this way we reach the isodual formulation of the Poincaré symmetry, so that we had a consistent, axiomatically correct space-time symmetry for our characterization of antimatter. In conclusion, our group has reconstructed step by step under the isodual map the entire mathematics underlying the special relativity. And the next step was, of course, the construction of the isodual image of the mathematics underlying general relativity. We indicated before that the first step is to construct the isodual image of the Riemannian space, and of course, and related line element that again coincides with the conventional element. After that, we have to construct the isodual image of all the methods underlying the Riemannian geometry that are well known, such as exterior derivative, covariant derivative, Christoffel symbols, etc. And here is a list of some of the quantity that are essential for the elaboration of gravitational model via the Riemannian geometry. Again, if each and every part, each and every symbol, each and every quantity of the Riemannian geometry is subjected systematically to the isodual map, there is the emergence of this isodual Riemannian geometry, which is fully consistent. And indeed, does permit the representation of the gravitational field of an antimatter body. The point which is very intriguing is that the curvature tensor is negative, but careful, it is negative, but refer to a negative unit. Remember again, over and over again, under the isodual map, not only you have to conjugate a certain quantity, but you have to conjugate also the unit. So if you conjugate, for instance, the space, the distance, let's say 10 centimeters, you have necessarily, for consistency, you have to conjugate also the unit, which is 1 centimeter. So you have minus 10 centimeter, which are referred to the unit, which is minus 1 centimeter. The same is for time. You end up with antimatter, they have a negative time. So but the negative time is referred to a negative unit of time, as we will see in the lecture of level 3. Then an evolution along a negative time, when referred to a negative unit of time, is as causal as an evolution along a positive value of time referred to a positive unit of time. The same happens for energy. Energy has to be necessarily conjugated. So antiparticle have a negative energy. But again, careful, because this negative energy is referred to a negative unit of energy. And again, the negative energy, which normally are very unphysical, that's the very reason why Dirac was forced to discover and work out this model of whole theory. But now, in isodual mathematics, negative energy are fully causal because they are referred to a negative unit of energy. So they are exactly as causal as a positive energy referred to a positive unit of energy. Now, back to the curvature. Here we have a negative curvature, which is, however, within the context of the isodual Riemannian geometry, is referred to a negative unit. So therefore, indicates attraction. As it is, so namely an antimatter test mass is indeed attracted by an antimatter mass. Think about a star which is made up of an antimatter and a planet which is made also of antimatter. That planet will be attracted in exactly the same way, even though, however, careful, that the curvature tensor is negative definite. However, the interesting part is when you have a matter body that is immersed within an antimatter planetary system, or vice versa, then you have a gravitational repulsion. Namely, when you have this isodual Riemannian geometry, in which that characterizes the gravity of an antimatter star, and supposing that antimatter star there is a matter asteroid that penetrates, then that matter asteroid is predicted to be repelled, and vice versa. So, for instance, the antiparticle, when traveling horizontally on our Earth, are predicted to be repelled, so to move upward, when under the influence of our gravitational field. This is extremely interesting because essentially it's the first mathematical mathematically rigorous formulation of a millenary dream of mankind, namely anti-gravity. And this will be the subject of very extensive studies and proposal presented in level 5 of this series. The entire isodual mathematics that has been presented up to this point must be solely referred to point-like antiparticles moving in empty space. That is because this is also the case of applicability of the conventional mathematics. If we have extended antiparticles moving within the interior of an antimatter body, then what the proper treatment required, the isodual map of isomathematics. Remember, isomathematics was developed to represent the interior condition of matter. In this case, now we have to study the interior condition of antimatter. And the mathematics is given by applying the isodual map, in this case, not to conventional mathematics, but to isomathematics. So you start with an arbitrary integral differential unit that we presented in details in lecture 2A and 2B, and that is only restricted by the condition of being positive definite, but as an arbitrary functional dependence, then you have to subject that quantity to isoduality, since that is Hermitian, so basically you change the sign. But you have to apply this map to the entire isomathematics, and you have to be careful to avoid inconsistency, otherwise you will not be able, otherwise you'll have surprise in studying interior problem of antimatter. This isodual isomathematics is presented in details in that monograph published by Springer, and I refer you to them. Similarly, if you study irreversible processes of antimatter, then the isodual isomathematics is basically insufficient. What you have to do, an isodual map of the geno mathematics. So if you want of a Li admissible formulation of hadronic mechanics, so you have another branch of hadronic mechanics, namely the treatment of antimatter in irreversible conditions. Again, for the conventional irreversible treatment of matter, we have two different isounits with two different or corresponding ordered products, one for motion forward in time and the other inequivalent for the motion backward in time. Each of them has to be subjected to the isodual map. It's a very simple, lengthy operation, but it works very well, and it leads indeed to this additional the mathematics, which is isodual geno mathematics. The confirmation, the verification that the isodual map, when formulated in isodual space, is equivalent to charge conjugation is trivial, because the isodual map was conceived from charge conjugation. The only novelty is that isodual map, as we indicated before, applies at all levels, beginning from the classical formulation formulation all the way to quantum mechanics. But when you go to the level of quantum mechanics, then the equivalence of the two maps is trivial. The only thing, the difference is that for charge conjugation, antiparticles are represented in our spacetime, while for the isodual map, antiparticles exist in a conjugate spacetime coexisting with our own. However, keep in mind that the line elements are invariant under isoduality, so consequently this the differentiation of the physical space in which antimatter exists compared to matter has no impact on the equivalence between charge conjugation and isoduality. You can see the calculations also applied specifically to the Klein-Gordon equation and many other equations. Remember, the Dirac equation is invariant under isoduality, so this is even more trivial. As a result of these occurrences, the isodual theory antimatter verifies the totality of experimental evidence available on antimatter up to this moment, at all level, beginning from, as you will see in the lecture of level 3, beginning from Newton, the Newtonian treatment of antiparticle is experimentally verified 100% all the way to the operator formulation. In closing, I would like to indicate the connection between the isodual mathematics and our formulation of multivalued hypermathematics. The reason is that when you combine the conventional mathematics and isodual mathematics, you do have indeed a multivalued hyperstructure, or you can formulate both of them in one single structure by basing, assuming here, in, as indicated in this point, assuming a two-valued basic unit, one with a positive and the other negative, one representing matter and the other representing antimatter, then you you introduce a two-valued product, and so on. You construct the entire two-valued hyperstructure, and with one single formulation, you represent both conventional mathematics and isodual mathematics. From a physical viewpoint, as we will see, in the lecture of level 3, this is very important, because this implies that an isoself dual universe, namely universe made of 50% matter and 50% antimatter, all physical characteristics are identically null. The total time is zero, the total energy is zero, the total linear momentum is zero, etc., etc. So this is opens some very intriguing epistemological aspect. Of course, again, this this condition of equal percentage of matter and antimatter should be considered as limiting, essentially ideal condition. Nevertheless, the two-valued hyperstructure of formulation of conventional mathematics and this isodual is very intriguing, and it is recommended as a unified treatment. Thank you for your attention.